Well, thank you again, Mr. Zimmerman, for agreeing to be interviewed. We're really looking forward to hear what you have to say about church planting movements and so on. So can you first introduce yourself? Tell us a little bit about what you do in life.
Yeah, thank you. Obviously, my name is Tait, and I live up in Alaska. I've lived up here my whole life. And so Dad came up when he was 5 years old, or his family came up, mm-hmm. and so 1960, and it's kind of a rare thing up here is to be up here this long or have the roots here. And so I'm the father of four boys, uh-huh. and we have one on the way, and very, very happily married, and to my wife, Lauren. I do real estate in our family real estate business up here in Alaska, and love what I do there. Mm-hmm. Also taking the role of provisional church leadership in our local church. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So doing a lot with the people in our church and, mm-hmm. and trying to reach out into the community and have a heart for this area, this community, and, yeah. and how we can see an impact here for the Lord Jesus Christ and his kingdom.
Awesome. That's great. So, have you ever worked on an Alaskan fishing boat? Lobster fishing?
No, I haven't.
Well, that's just destroyed some of my opinion. No, all I know about Alaska is that where it is and that people do crab fishing. Having watched The Deadliest Catch, I feel as if I know Alaska.
Well, you need to get caught up on some more of the reality shows, because there's a lot more than...
Oh, there's more reality shows. Oh, wonderful. Well, that's wonderful. That's great. So
I probably watched 3 episodes.
That's a super show. And by the way, in the UK version, they have a Scottish guy giving the commentary, and it's very Scottish, oh, wow. You see. Can you tell us a little bit about how you came across the faith for all of life perspective, the biblical worldview, as it were?
I'll have to back up a little bit. My parents were not Christians. Mm-hmm. My grandparents were not, well, on one side, nominally Christian. So don't come from a Christian background as far as that goes. And my parents came to the Lord when I was 6 years old. Before that, they were off into drugs and, you know, all kinds of problems, about to get divorced. And actually, I was almost aborted.
Wow.
So what happened is somebody came into their life, and of all things, and I'm not part of the Amway business now, but it was somebody in the Amway business, okay. who used it as kind of a platform. And he actually... several of the people in our local church and people that we know in this community, he was able to, same story, he basically presented the gospel, discipled, and so they came to the Lord, and God worked there, and then as a result, of course, I came to the Lord, and have my own kind of, you know, story there as far as the ups and the downs, but anyways.
Awesome. Praise God for that.
Yeah. So we came from a very eclectic beginning of Christianity. Mm-hmm. As much as I'm grateful for the foundation, we were at the beginning listening to everybody from John Hagee to, you know, probably John MacArthur to, you know, there was a lot of Baptist, sure. and charismatic, yeah. and it, just all kinds of stuff. Somehow we came across a, dad came across a, Rush Dooney's Institutes.
Okay.
Biblical law. And he had read through it, but it didn't quite, as far as the world, you didn't quite sink in at that point. And I was probably like 8 years old. He encouraged me. I picked it up, and I was having a hard time stumbling through it. And he said, oh, someday you need to read this.
Wow, so, 8 years old, eh? Wow.
Yeah, but sure, I didn't read it then. So, yep. But I was excited to be able to read it at some point when my comprehension caught up. And so... you know, we came from this interesting background where we weren't part of a local church. We did a little, you know, Bible study in somebody's home or, you know, small church for a while. And I started picking up Rush Dooney's Institutes of Biblical Law and reading through it. And that had a huge impact on my thinking. That's how I was introduced to, you know, Reformed Christianity, the sovereignty of God, postmillennialism, theonomy, all those kind of things. And it trickled back. The family, you know, is on the same page. What was interesting is we actually started attending a Baptist church, a dispensational Baptist church plant. And at the beginning of that church plant, attending. You know, we went there for 2 or 3 years. We didn't know what dispensationalism was. We didn't know what, you know, the theology was behind it. And as we were reading and growing and having conversations, it was a huge period of growth because we were able to you know, reading these things from Rush and other people, they contrasted with what we were being taught on Sunday. It was a really interesting time period, but a huge time of growth, and became more reformed in the process and started adopting the perspective of faith for all of life and the different spheres of sovereignty and God's sovereignty over all the different spheres.
Yeah. So were there any particular books you mentioned, the Institutes of Biblical Law or authors you mentioned, Rushdoony, anything particular that really helped you, or just the whole gamut?
I've read, you know, over a dozen of Rushdoony's books. I've read Institutes of Biblical Law 2 or 3 times, Law Society multiple times. Those probably had the biggest impact. I would say more recently, I've gotten into John Calvin's Institutes and really love his commentaries and institute or his institutes. Sim Van Til as well, Johnson. You know, some of those authors were very influential in my thinking. And what's funny is, as I've been exposed to, because that's, I assumed that that's the way all of Reformed Christianity was.
Yeah, sure.
So, yeah. Even more recently, joining Facebook groups and being part of conversations, even with the assumption that this is what it looks like, and come to find out it's very different today because of Reformed Two Kingdoms and other aspects. So, that's been a shock.
Well, I hope you didn't take it too personally, or get.
No, but I think other people did when I came in instantly. Stumbled in with my Rushdoony quotes.
you didn't get the memo, you know. It is hard to see to some extent why they aren't our best friends. But anyway, that's another discussion and so on. But very good. That's very helpful. And a lot of those books are available for purchase for a small fee on calcedon.edu or free even a lot of. Articles written by Banson and a lot of stuff by Gary North is available free and so on if you want to follow that up.
Mm-hmm. And I'd like to add one other little piece to that story is when I was studying these things, I realized, okay, I really feel called to some kind of ministry, some kind of Great Commission work. And so I went down to a series of conferences, including a Calcedon conference, and I actually met my wife at a American Vision event.
Yay.
In the cafeteria. So, but that's some of the background too, that exposure to meeting different people in those circles.
I'm sure you would encourage people to do likewise, to meet people, meet up with folks. That's great. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about church planting movements, which people might think they know what it is, but it might not be what they think. Can you give us a little thumbnail sketch of what church planting movements are? Is and what their distinguishing features are against your ordinary run-of-the-mill church planting, perhaps?
Yeah, yep. There's over 40 church planting movements in the world today. As we all know, the gospel is exploding in other countries in a way that sometimes we may not see here in the United States, and we're praying for. And a lot of it started with the Bhojpuri speaking people in India. In the church planting movement there. On the foreign mission field, some of the differences are very stark in that it tends to be a non-denominational approach. It doesn't mean that denominations can't participate or aren't involved, but what it oftentimes precludes is taking the fine points of Christianity that we've honed over thousands of years and expecting those to fit into an Indian culture or a Muslim culture. So an example of that would be a lot of times there's been points of contention, especially in the Muslim world. For example, an ordained pastor has to baptize the women, the ladies. Well, in a Muslim country, that's really not a hill to die on, and it's become, you know, those type of things have been stumbling stones for. It's really picking and choosing the battles. What does Scripture say, and how do we approach this culture with the gospel, mm-hmm. with the gospel, with the Bible, and what the results are going to look a little bit different than what we have in America. I'd say some of the differences, and this isn't to demean your traditional missionary work, but I did meet a lot of missionaries who had tried one way and then
awesome.
And now are part of church planting movement.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the big things is success. There's over a 15-year period in India with the Bhojpuri-speaking people. There was over 80,000 churches planted, roughly 60
awesome.
Members per church. There's 30,000 churches in Africa in a 10 to 11-year period. So they're seeing huge success around the world. It's taking off. I have a little bit of a list here. So
mm-hmm.
discovery-based Bible studies. Well, let me start with person of peace. There's
okay,
a,
just
there's
to give a little
preface
here, these are the distinctives, and they may sound a little bit weird, but don't write it off immediately.
Yeah, and I realize this. Some of us might take what you can from this because it's not necessarily what you'd find here in the Reformed churches, but I think the principles are sound. The one of the key concepts is person of peace. So when you go into communities, based off of the passage in the Gospels where it talks about looking for that person of peace that receives you into the house and, provides for your needs, those kind of things. So one of the concepts is that when you go into these communities or in your local community, there's certain people that God has already positioned in a place where they already have networks of people that they are interacting with. And so you're just on the lookout, receptive for those people of peace. And they're the people that are interacting, they're interested, they ask questions, they don't write you off, hospitable, whatever the case is. There's an opening there. And a lot of times they're connected with other people as well. And so a lot of times in foreign countries especially, they see that person of peace being a gateway into a whole community. Sometimes it's the tribal chief. Oftentimes in Muslim countries, it's the imam or the Muslim leader in the area who actually becomes the person of peace.
Yes, very interesting. And I can think of Northern Ireland and the context there. And for a Protestant to go into a Catholic community, you just can't do that. You'll be your house will be burnt down to the ground or something.
Mm-hmm.
Or you'll get their tire slashed, or
yeah,
they'll put a bomb under your car. So it's
yeah,
like that or worse. And if you go from tribe to tribe in Africa, there's a lot of friction there. Obviously, some similar things in India. Multiply it by 10 when you go from a Hindu to a Muslim background, or Christian to the Muslim, Christian to Hindu. So yeah, very interesting. Go ahead there. What are some of the other distinctives?
Let me start with discovery Bible study. There's this concept of discovery Bible study, and discovery Bible study is basically, effectively, it's where you have a disciple, and sometimes it's their friends, especially if it's a person of peace, and through whatever means, you're now sitting down with that person, and you're going through the scriptures, and you take a short section of scriptures, basically three columns, you have them write that scripture out by hand.
Awesome.
And there's a certain reason for that because it creates memory, it sticks better. We actually just did this last night as a Bible study.
Yeah, I'm writing my way through the book of Proverbs at the moment. It's a very worthwhile exercise.
And then you write it in the second column, you write that passage and you paraphrase it and put it in your understanding of the scriptures.
Awesome.
The third section is obedience. So it's in terms of, based off of this, I need to be, or I need to, or I should, or obedience-based statements about the passage. So not just going through scripture endlessly, what are we going to take away and actually implement in our lives?
Mm-hmm.
And not that it has to be that three-column approach, but the basic premise is as people study the Bible, the Holy Spirit works.
Mm-hmm.
And as they ask obedience-based questions, how do we obey this individually and as a group, you start seeing obedience. And they do that through the Old Testament and the New Testament.
It makes me think of what I heard Brother Andrew say once in a meeting in Switzerland. He said that we shouldn't read any more of the Bible until we start obeying the bits that we've already
yeah.
read. And then it ties in with Rustuni's characterization of the Bible as the law word of God. It makes demands of us. It is a law word. Anything he says, even outside of the passages of law, is law by virtue of him being king.
Mm-hmm.
So, wow, great.
So that's honestly one of the biggest aspects.
Yeah.
If that wasn't there, I wouldn't be as excited about the quote-unquote church planting movement or some of these concepts, because obedience is so key.
Mm.
And just multiplying and seeing multiplication without obedience or mechanism for obedience is obviously that we see the problems there. There's the basic emphasis on the commands for individuals and churches to reproduce as part of the Great Commission. So there's this emphasis on bearing fruit as obedience, but it's also spiritual reproduction, that this is the time of the harvest, and that we are called to go out in the fields and to bring in those, you know, obviously God does it, but he uses the means of humans to, for the winning of souls. And so there's a huge emphasis on each believer is called to spiritually reproduce. Each church is called to, in a sense, reproduce as well. And so really one of the other things I love about the church planting movement is something I've learned from the Reformed faith, and that is the emphasis on the local church, the importance of the local church. You're not just trying to evangelize a bunch of people who are then going to be disconnected from other Christians. You understand that they have to be in bodies of local other believers as quickly as possible, where there's accountability, there's leadership, and they have a role, a function in that body to play. So spiritual reproduction is key, and local churches are
awesome.
Key.
Yeah. Is there a good book that you would recommend, or a website, if people wanted to find out more about church planting movements?
I would recommend reading the article. I have the title. What I started with was Gary Norris beating. It's an article on his website called Beating the State, Third Century Christianity in the Third World Today. So that's what got me interested. There's Contagious Discipleship. There's also the book Miraculous Movements. And some of these books are going to have aspects that rub some of us, including myself, the wrong way. Now, I approach it with an open mind, but there's certain things that, you know, I'm going to pick out eat the meat and spit out the bones, the same as anything else. So.
Well, absolutely. And, you know, just because we are theonomists or reconstructionists or reformed people or whatever we want to call ourselves doesn't mean that we think that we have all the answers. We must have the humility to believe to see God's work, God's Holy Spirit working through other folks. Mm-hmm. Now, how did you come across church planting movements? And
it was through that article, a member of our local church who was following Gary Norris' blog brought that to my attention. And so in the article, there's a video of David Watson, who was one of the people who helped start up the church planting movement. And so I watched that video, read the article. And from there, I kind of realized that, okay, I want to get more. There was a lot of things in my life and experiences in my life that led up to that point. Two things. Number one, I was an intern at a big ministry that later on had issues, and I saw even before it had the issues that, okay, these are good things being taught. People are coming to these classes and conferences and seminars, but where's the call to action when they go back home? And started to realize that in the local church we can be the same way, that people come, they're fed, but where's the call to action, the equipping for of the saints? Ephesians 4, it's not equipping, it's not endless feeding, it's the apostles, the prophets, the teachers, etc. are to, they're for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry.
That's right.
And one other influence was that our church, basically, I had seen at a certain point the need for a local church in our community. Several of the families here saw the same thing. And we kind of grew as a church out of nowhere. So
it wasn't just the article, there were circumstances that were helping point you towards this. Very good. So what has your experience with church planting movements been in the U.S.?
The church planting movement, my experience there in the U.S. would be that we basically, in a sense, why it resonated with me is because our church, starting from a few families meeting together, now 8 to 10 families meeting together on a regular basis and deeply enriched by being members of a local church and heading towards biblical structure and leadership at this point, so kind of learning as we go, the message really resonated with me because I had, in a sense, been part of a kind of an aspect, not an ideal aspect, because usually these churches are planted, but I've kind of been through the process all the way back to the fact that the person who influenced my parents and the other family, some of the other families, really use that business model as an access-based ministry of sorts.
Sure.
Even though I wouldn't, it's not the one I'm going to pursue.
Okay. Now, you haven't just come across the church planting movement thing in the United States of the America, but also you went to Asia. So what did you see? What insights did you glean? Did you get deli belly? How was it? What can you tell us about it?
Thankfully, no deli belly. We actually did a street food tour, and it was a TripAdvisor approved guide to all places that we wouldn't have gone otherwise. So, but we stayed clear of that. We after reading the article, I did some research to see, okay, where can I go and learn about this? And a lot of it was pointing back to India. So I found an organization, Asia Partners International, who keeps in touch and does a lot in India. And so we went over, they helped arrange the trip, and it was an excellent time. One of the things that helped for both Lauren and myself was, number one, I feel like if I hadn't gone over, it would have been a passing article that I would have read, been excited about, not know how to implement anything that I had seen there, and it would have just been in the background, oh yeah, that's a great idea, but never would have, you know, possibly wouldn't have seen the fruit. So it cemented the church planting movement, discipleship making movement in my mind as being important by seeing practical examples and sitting down in rooms with a room with, you know, five or six tribal Christian leaders who had planted 25 to 50 churches each. And this guy sitting on my right hand had helped the guy sitting next to him, and each one of them had planted 25 churches. So one was the disciple. So seeing the fruit in person was really good. Lauren, up to that point, had tons of questions, and as is the case, a lot of times it's hard to pass things on to our wives the way we should. And so for her, it really helped her to get on the same page as we sat and learned together. We saw examples of what they have over there as access-based ministries. So basically, the saints washing feet, meeting needs in the community, true religion being practiced, and see some of their specific applications of that in their culture. It was very helpful.
So were there any particular questions that got answered? Were there any particular insights you thought, aha, yes, I can now apply this in X, Y, and Z way? Or
a lot of things that I've probably covered. One thing was that hit home was the aspect of we tend to think of leadership as in the church as teaching, and I'm not downplaying the role of teaching. But statistically, you're only going to remember a certain percentage of what you're taught. What they emphasized is that leadership also involves the bulk of leadership. In fact, in a sense, is modeling, is leading, is including people in your life as a leader. And taking them out on the mission fields, doing ministry activities. So it's not just a classroom setting, it's actually, you know, lifestyle leadership in a sense.
Awesome.
So that really clicked with me.
It was funny, I was listening to a particular conservative media talk show host, Alex Jones. I occasionally listen to him, but and I think what he was saying was true as a trend in the media, and this is just the media, that people want honesty, and people want no more fake news, as one of the websites is, and how much more in relationships with people, and even in church, and there's no greater way of proving that you're sincere by actually living it out. So it's we're clearly on to something here. So you've mentioned a few strong points biblically. Anything else you'd like to add? What are maybe some of the other strong points of church planting movements biblically, or would you want to emphasize anything in particular?
Obviously, I've covered obedience, but there's also biblical commands to be fruitful, and sometimes because of different off-the-wall emphasis on, like, health and wealth and prosperity gospel, and some some things, an emphasis on the ends justifies the means, and some of those things lead us to discount fruit. And there is the aspect of faithfulness, even if there's no fruit. But there's also kind of a command to fruit, to bear fruit. And so we really need to both be obedient and to gear our methods in such a way that we're able to actually produce fruit. So if I'm doing things in such a way that's not producing fruit, right, and I'm thinking that I'm being faithful, but there's ways I could think outside of those, that box that I'm in, to be faithful, that, you know, I think I need to consider that so that I can produce fruit for the kingdom of God.
I mean, various different things. What are you particularly thinking of in terms of fruit?
I'm speaking of, in this specific context, of, you know, disciples made, churches planted, relationships increased, Bible studies started, you know, the work of the Great Commission proceeding and actually fleshing out in the local area.
And yes, is there anything in your opinion that might need to change in CPMs, or particular emphasis that might need to be emphasized to help reach what we consider at least sophisticated Western world, which has its own set of religious barriers to belief, as fine as it is, and we're obviously wanting to disciple the nations, so it might not, the emphasis might have to change. So any thoughts on that? Anything that might have to change within the church planting movements to give it a more solid emphasis, or what do you think?
We're actually being trained in a sense by an organization, city team, that's been involved in church planting movements around the world, and just learning from them as far as they're giving us some group coaching as far as developing a team here in America. They've seen some success. A lot of the success has been in, say, the Hispanic communities, cultures that have a largely more of a community mindset, but they have seen success outside. Honestly, I think we do have the challenge that a lot of people here, if you say, are you a Christian, are going to say, yeah, I'm Christian. Mm-hmm. You know, they might have to think about it for 10 seconds, but there, you deal with that here in America. So I think one of the benefits of the things that we've been learning is the flexibility. And I would say that in many ways, what we've been doing as a church as a whole, just speaking generally, isn't working in this hardened soil. You know, we're barely holding on, if anything. And so we need to be brainstorming. And that's what we went over to India, is how do we take these principles back to Alaska and the United States? And some of it boils down to, how do we reach out to our communities? What needs need to be met in the communities? And honestly, my heart is for this area. I'm not, my heart isn't, you know, to go overseas at this point. I'm not saying it'd be different. But if I have to stand outside of an abortion clinic and have conversations, gospel conversations, with people, with moms going in or parents going in for 1 year, and I see maybe one or two discipleships, one or two turnaways, those type of things, it's not just about the numbers. And so even here in somewhat hardened soil, you got to keep that in mind. It's not just about the numbers, and it may not look like it is over in some of these other countries where it's just rapidly exploding. But if we can be more effective and more fruitful and more obedient in the process, even if the numbers aren't quite as dramatic or as exciting, now I pray for those things. I pray for success on a larger scale. But at the same time, having a handful of disciples and maybe planting a couple churches in the local community eventually, to me, would be success. So I would say that hardened soil, the hardened hearts, is probably the biggest thing we have to deal with. How do we develop the relationship with those people that think they have it figured out because they're Americans? And how do we reach out to them when they're at their lowest point, you know, by serving them and meeting them and meeting their needs and helping them, the Church of Jesus Christ.
And I've learned a bit, I hope, observing what folks are doing in Alabama, in Moulton there, with their community approach there. They've been at it for a long time, and they have a multi-pronged strategy. So I'm sure you've come across Mr. Yarbrough.
I have, just vaguely, but I'm not like
Yeah, well, I would certainly recommend getting in touch with him and see what he's doing in his local area. He has a number of ongoing local-based strategies on a number of prongs, and he's very much a believer in working where he's put, you know. Very good. So being flexible, you think, is pretty important. Being willing to change your approach, cast the net on the other side of the boat is pretty important as well. A community having a local focus is pretty important, you think?
One additional thought, and this is probably one of the more maybe controversial with the crowd that this will probably be getting out to. And it's not meant to be stepping on toes, but I think it might. And that is one of the concepts that I've heard within the church planting movement is that an oak tree doesn't start out as an oak tree. It starts out as an acorn. And it grows as a sapling, it grows up and turns into an oak tree. So often, what we're looking for, either with disciples or with local churches, is many times we want to start nearly full-fledged oak trees rather than being willing to go through the acorn, the sapling, and on to the oak tree stage. And if you look, say, for example, the book of Corinthians, Paul's speaking to a church that in many ways is out of line, yet he seems to be relatively optimistic. Yeah, at different points as far as the growth, he doesn't abandon this church, but there's some huge issues with the church, and you see that as the book of, as Corinthians unfolds. And sometimes I think within the Reformed community, we don't tolerate that acorn and sapling stage, and that acorn and sapling stage where things are going to be a little bit chaotic, they are going to be a little bit unorganized in a church plant or startup. That's part of life. That's part of, the church planting movement, and it's part of why they're seeing the success that they're at. And part of it comes down to really the Holy Spirit and the Word of God can work in a local group of people, and in the life of an individual. Or do we feel like we have to just narrow the parameters so tightly that nothing could possibly happen
Yes.
outside of control?
Well, two things springs to mind there. I think what happens in particularly Reformed churches is that the goal posts and the measurements are changed so that it's perhaps impossible for anyone to feel, possible for a church to feel, in that it's like as if I had a class teaching English, and one of the things that I measured attendance, I measured how well they behaved in class, but I didn't actually measure how well they spoke English, you know, either coming in or going out. And there's just an awful lot. I don't want to be overly cynical, but there's a lot of play pretend in church. Don't measure this. Let's just pretend that everybody is a mature Christian because they can maybe sit well in church, or maybe even the elders are able to juggle theological concepts in their head. But obedience isn't as within certain parameters, obedience is measured, but outside of those parameters, it isn't. Another thing that, so the question of how mature and how Christian a church might be, well, you can score an 8 or you can score a 0, depending on where you measure. So all that to say is that an immature church may be a lot more mature in the faith than in applying the faith than a very well established one. A second thing that occurs that comes to mind is that to meet the needs, as it were, to address the issues that arose from false doctrine to sexual sins and so on, they didn't dumb it down. Nothing was dumbed down. It was high theology, as it were, the finer points of the incarnation or the Trinity, or just really, really, really difficult stuff. And even the book of Revelation is a letter to a persecuted church, but it's not just a manual on, you know, keep on going, fellas, you know, you can do it. It's the densest sort of theology possible, which requires a fundamental knowledge of the entire Bible. So perhaps we're thinking about this in the wrong way, that all this teaching will be necessary just to address the needs of the average Indian, the average African. And I was doing my little write-up for the post-millennial report, finishing up something in Africa, and it occurred to me that, well, wait a minute, Africans don't just need the ABCs, they have to live life as well, and they face very, very complex issues, life and death issues, and you know, you just can't give them just, for example, just the shorter catechism was the example I chose. Well, that's excellent teaching, but you know, you need the whole works, you need the whole Bible. So perhaps the question to ask is, how can you make teaching available to folks that will be, that are in these communities, that are in these churches, and who are looking for answers? So I suppose you've asked some very complex questions in your time, I'm sure, as you got to know the Lord more and got to know the word more, and just faced issues as a parent, as a citizen, as a father, as a husband, and so on. And you know, you wanted the real answer, so why wouldn't other people, you know, we're not especially and uniquely sophisticated, so perhaps it's not a real issue, and they're not going to live lives in bubbles either, just having contact with their own church group. They're going to have access to the internet, and they're going to look for answers there as well. So I suppose bracing ourselves for getting ready to serve these people who are in Africa as best as we can. And I think also Gary Norris has made the point more than once that there is almost a division of labor between the denominational groups or the broader movements within evangelical Christianity, in that it was traditionally the Baptists that did all the evangelism. Meanwhile, the Presbyterians were writing their books. So that doesn't say it all, but it certainly leaves room for folks to actively reach out. And I think it is important that people consider the market for Christianity in the developing world. Anyway, I don't want to ramble on. I don't normally ramble on so much, but
and honestly, sometimes it's not pretty. Sometimes it's messy. The good news is when you have new believers and you have new churches that are, these new believers are filled with the Holy Spirit and they're Bible-centric, they value the Word of God, they take ownership of their faith, and they're hungry for the Word, all those other things can come later. All the maturity, all the worldview issues, the fine points that I know it's taken me years to come to, and I'm not there yet, and those can come. And there's a role for us to go and teach them, and there's a role to share those thoughts. Have you guys ever considered the role of civil government, or you know, how that fits in the Scripture? But you have a platform and a base to start from when you have redeemed believers in the Lord Jesus Christ and churches. And especially if you're taking this and realizing, okay, we're not plugging them into a artificial dispensational model right off the bat. We're teaching them to value the Word, and very good in many ways at saying, wait a second, that doesn't match up with the Word here. What are you trying to say? So.
Yes, and another thought is, if Uncle Gary North is correct, then we will see what he calls the great default. So, and we're seeing it right now, piecemeal in the U.S. certainly, with the bankruptcies of municipalities and so on. We're seeing it in the U.K. with the gradual decline and semi-privatization of the National Health Service. So the institutions of service that were taken by the state, talk about how to go and know the needs of the community, that those needs are only going to multiply as the infrastructure of the state winds itself down. So I think we need to be preparing ourselves to wash people's feet in our communities. And that might mean getting involved in a health ministry like longevity or young living or whatever it happens to be. But certainly I think you'll see we need to prepare for that, which may open doors that are now closed in the US and other Western countries. So let's just say somebody's listening and say, sounds interesting, you know, what would you advise them to do or go, or any advice for the interested listener?
That's a really good question. I mean, I would start with that article, you know, read a few books with an open mind, you know, discard the parts that you don't agree with, but take the time to look at them. I'd be happy to, you know, talk to anybody further. I'm not the end all be all. We've tried to develop relationships with different church planters and different organizations. So there's kind of growing market of information in this whole realm. It's not like you can point somebody to a specific website to get all the details figured out. It's actually there's more of a movement and less information available about the movement in ways. But there are some things available, and I'd be happy to talk to anybody. Just take some of these concepts and see if they mesh with scripture and in the local community, in your local church. I mean, what we're doing right now is we're brainstorming what needs are in our local community. How can we meet those needs? Because it should be the church and individual charity versus the government. And so we're trying to say, how can we reach out to people and in the process see disciples made, people want to Christ, and churches planted with those new disciples.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Is there anything else? Oh, thank you very much. Really appreciate that. And I find it useful to talk things through. Anything else that you might like to add as a parting thought for our hundreds of listeners?
I guess what probably is on my mind just at the moment is probably a level of frustration on part of church leaders across the country. I've read a book on health, you know, healthy church membership, and there's a lack of involvement and ownership of people in the church because we have this delegation mindset of so and so, he's in the ministry. But realize this show, the local church, is there to equip us to be our part of the body, to take ownership and to be part of the Great Commission work as local churches, as families. And anyways, just take, I'm sure people are on that process if they're listening to the show, because they probably wouldn't be listening otherwise, but let's all take ownership of our own Christianity. And I'm not discrediting working as a corporate group, but let's take our piece seriously of that corporate work.
Awesome. Thank you very much for those words. And we'll have all the books that you mentioned, the websites, and whatever contact details you want to give out listed in the show notes. And look forward to perhaps talking to you again, or shaking your hand, buying you a cup of tea or coffee if you must.
Yeah. you go down to Mexico, it sounds like.
Oh, so. Yeah. Well, why not? That would be great. We'd love to have you. Thank you very much, and go and bless now.